Okay, great, so let's start. Then, hello and good morning to another video. We are now at Mintos. You already know Martins, I think, from some other interviews we made, for example, last year at the same place, nearly the same place. It was the office
building.
I will put the link in the description for all those who have not seen the interview yet, so that we can skip the whole introduction and everything and just make an update interview, what has changed and so on. And I think I have some interesting questions for you in this interview. So maybe, Martins, we can start with a really, really short introduction of yourself for those who did not see the interview.
So I'm Martin Schulte. I'm CEO and co-founder of Mintos. Super happy to have you here. And welcome to our... This is already a new office. So last year we met in another office. And myself, I've been since the very beginning with the company and... seeing it grow so far.
Yeah, thank you so much. Also very happy to meet you here again. I mean, already now we know each other. Meanwhile, I think very good. We met in Stuttgart and so on. And always a pleasure to talk to you. And you are one of the most informed persons in this fintech and B2B. So maybe you can tell me what has changed in the business and the company since our last interview. Have there been some main changes except the office from another floor, I think, or something? But
I think the key word to use would be growth. So we have been continuing doing what we do. There's been a lot of actually growth, to be honest. I just looked up actually the numbers since the last time we met, actually, which was exactly a year ago, early June.
By luck, it was because the conference is now.
So basically, if you look at the numbers, so number of investors increased from 65,000 investors at that time to 145 today.
Oh, that's amazing.
Total invested from total 800 million to now 2.4 billion euros. And then also our team has grown considerably. So last time when we met, we were about 40 people. Now in the new office, we have about 110 people here. So there's been a lot of growth, a lot of things happening. And we continue bringing on new loan lending companies, new loan originators from different geographies. And now we are also expanding our kind of product offerings. That's what we are now working on. And also kind of thinking of what else we can give to you investors, what's the value we can provide.
Oh, thank you so much. It's very interesting. We will come to it later, I think, in the interview. Sure. I have prepared some questions in this direction.
Yeah.
And so Mintos is growing. People like me really love it. I loved investments. And you know that this is really authentic because I'm also in myself now, since the last year I also increased my investment. Mm-hmm. And I'm now with more than 50,000 euros on investment on Mintos. So it's not just for affiliate. I'm here really as an investor, investor of Mintos. And a lot of people ask me if the company might make an IPO or who is the owner of the company, how's the relationship to the owners. Maybe you can tell me something about that.
So basically you can think of Mintos as more or less like a typical startup. So we have raised money from a venture capital fund, or more likely we could call them like angel investors, a bunch of them. And then we, as a co-founders, we also own, of course, a share in the company. And we also give share options to all the employees. So all the employees also are shareholders of the company. About any kind of plans about IPO, well, we don't really think about it today. So it's so much things happening. So it's so much kind of opportunity ahead of us. And I think we are just really now getting started. So bringing on new investment opportunities for investors, bringing on like new products which we can offer. So to be honest, like this is definitely not the top thing what me or anyone else would think about it, like IPO or exit. So at this moment, nothing in that direction, definitely.
To be honest, it's really amazing that this grows for us to watch it also as an investor and also as a friend of the company, I have to say, meanwhile, because I'm here very often and I really appreciate it. yes, of course, and I think maybe you are right that it's at least still an early stage, and nobody knows what comes one day, but I really would be happy maybe if I could also be shareholder of this company.
Sure. We will let you know.
Okay, you let me know, great. Then maybe we can also come back, because I got some questions in this direction, about the last financial report. We received it some weeks ago per email. to be honest, I'm not so in the figures. Yeah, you are much better in this, of course, as a CEO. Yeah. But maybe you can just give us an easy, short summary about this last year.
Yeah, again, it was all about the growth. Obviously, it's already 2018, which is in our world like way back in time, because now it's already half year behind.
True.
But 2019, we closed with double revenue than 2017. We closed with $5 million revenue. We continue to invest a lot in growth. So and even with that much investment in growth, we still, although very small, but still remain profitable, which just speaks of the kind of a business model which we have, right? And the year went by, again, this, I would describe the same word what I use, it's all about the growth. So it's been very much focusing on growing both sides of the marketplace. So first of all, it's definitely about bringing on more loan supply, bringing on more lending companies which provide those loans. And then now today, when we actually, we have a lot of, so if you go on the marketplace, even today, you're going to see that there's like hundreds of thousands of loans available. So now we are maybe shifting more focus on actually investor acquisition, because there's actually more loan supply than investor demand at this moment. But 2019 was a great year, but still this year we continue growing and continue also growing in terms of revenue.
Okay, that's... Yeah, great. So you're still profitable. Also, this last year has been profitable.
Last year was profitable. Now, perhaps when we it depends on month on month. So it depends on our marketing spend and also how much we hire. So some months we have not been, but overall, actually, till today, we are actually still making profit for this year.
Well, I'm not so...
But you have to keep it in order to invest a lot and grow. So we continue growing 8 to 10% months over months. So there's a lot of growth behind it. So profit is not something which we are necessarily like optimizing for today.
I remember our last interview.
Yeah, yep.
And you told me, okay, 2018, I'm not sure if we are profitable, and at least you were. But I just have to read these questions. Yeah, exactly. You already said this. Anyway, this year the net profit was only 13,496 euros, which is, of course, a very, very small profit as compared to the last year, 2017. So if I got you right. But it's everything, as you said, in your guideline and with the growth. And maybe you can, I think already started this, but maybe you can tell us a bit more about the outlook, financial outlook 2019 and the next years.
It's going to be in line with our growth numbers. So basically what we see in the happening on the marketplace, that's also very much directly translates with some lag to our kind of revenue. So this year, most likely we will close also again with doubling the revenue from the last year. We have expanded the team significantly. We are moving into the new office. We are spending more on marketing. So not necessarily today, we are very much, not necessarily today, we are focusing on like profitability. Yeah. And this is not the key metric which we look at today. It's more about actually the business fundamentals, building out the marketplace and building for sustainability. It's not about like having more profit today. It's more about like sustainability in the future.
In the future, okay. I see. So everything in the guideline, and don't need to worry about the bankruptcy or something.
No, that's definitely like something.
Okay.
Well, you never know. Also, like,
of course,
big companies can go under.
I have seen that. Yeah.
But well, in general, that's not what we are.
But you take care as a CEO about that.
Sure. Of course.
Okay. Great. So I got some user questions just in the morning. I did not have the time to prepare it, but I will change the WhatsApp and just try to read the question of this. Urs is his name. He wrote me, which of the that was a typing mistake. Which of the loan originators present on Mintos are related parties to Mintos?
The easiest is just to go on the website. So for everywhere, we might have some overlap with the shareholders or any other kind of connections, which would then make them affiliated kind of loan originator. We show it on the website. So the easiest is to show them on the website. I don't know by heart all of them.
Okay, so just on the website, and then it's shown where it's related. Okay, what is the reason those who would qualify under IFRS as a related party I don't know.
Yeah, so IFRS is basically reporting standards, so international financial reporting standards, and we also qualify our cooperation partners or lending companies or loan originators, either kind of related or unrelated, and then that's going to depend on the definition. So in usually it's about like shareholder overlap or some kind of influence in general. Actually, only a few would be considered related parties according to I4S. A tiny bit more would be affiliated, and that's what we show also on the website.
Okay, I hope, Urs, this is enough answer for you. If not, you can write it in the comments. Yeah. Information. Then the second question he gave me is information about the loan originators on your website is quite old, he says, and incomplete. We are sure that in the process of your ongoing due diligence, you receive updated data. Why is it not uploaded? Could it be shared with the investors?
So basically, when we talk about information, so what we have to take into account that we are at the mercy of lending companies, of the loan originators. So what they provide is only what we can provide to investors. So if you get something, you definitely post it. And then we have to take into account that all the loan originators are, except for one or two, are private companies. So that means that they don't have like quarterly reporting in place. Most likely they have annual reports only. They might be some lag. So, and that's today we have like 61 different lending companies on the marketplace. So it's a lot. And they come from all sorts of different 30 different countries, right? So the reporting standards and timelines are very different. And we are very much kind of dependent on what they can provide. And we do our best to provide as much as possible. Of course, it's not, I mean, they are private companies, they're not public, so that's also we have to take into account.
But you really keep everything updated?
As much as we can, as much as we can, so of course, as much as we can, if you see that there's something missing. And we also have to take into account that some of the information which we get is kind of management report type of information, which is not for kind of public, right? So because they are private companies, what they can put is, say, annual reports. But some if they put some other information, some of them, for instance, have issued bonds, right? If they put the information on Mintos, they actually have to notify first the bondholder. So it's not that easy to get it. As much as we want to have like super clear, this is a standardized report, this is what you send, of course it's not really possible, especially given that we work with so many different companies, from very small lending companies to very big lending companies in, I don't know, in Mexico, in Botswana, in Philippines, and then everything in between. So you can imagine like the diversity of the lending companies we have.
Yeah, sure, but this is of course a big task for you and makes it more difficult to provide everything because it's so far over the whole world, but on the other side it's a really cool diversification, and that's what I appreciate as an investor, because also, to be honest to the viewers, it's not my only asset allocation to put everything on Mintos for sure, and not everything in B2B. There is also other platforms I'm invested in, and other kind of B2B loans, for example, and P2B loans, the real estate development and so on, of course. And it's also, all in all, only one part of the asset allocation. I think you should always try to have diversification through all the countries, which is very good with Mintos, but also between different assets like shares and so on. So it should just be one part, but Mintos gives me a good opportunity to make a big diversification because of this, all these countries and all these different kind of loans you offer on one platform.
Exactly. And then just to add, I guess it's also what we do is we focus, obviously we also focus on the financials of the lending companies, but we very much focus on loan performance, which by itself is much more important actually than the financials of lending company, because the financials are very much a lagging indicator, so you can only look what's happening behind you and most likely with some time lag. With the loan performance, we get the data like real time, so whenever the borrower makes a repayment, we see it like straight away, right? So we can do much more kind of monitoring on loan performance basis, and that by itself is more important actually, because at the end of the day, the investors, yes, with a buyback guarantee, of course the lending company is very important, but the investors are buying the underlying loans, so they actually get the loan. And if the loan is performing, then this buyback guarantee, I mean, yes, it's for your safety, but it doesn't really matter how good is a lending company financials. So it's very much the loan performance is so crucial in all the kind of decisions where to invest or where not to.
it's always difficult when I make the video to get all this information you give me, yeah, because yeah. I'm always thinking, is it working and so on, but try to follow everything. And it's really interesting, yeah, because I also think it's amazing how it can work that you can monitor all these loans, the payments, yeah, mm-hmm. It must be an genius fintech software. Where I mean, for me, I cannot really understand how it works. Yeah, maybe you can tell it in easy explanation.
In very easy terms, it would be so. Basically, we have connection, which is like API. So basically, we have connection to the softwares of the lending companies, right? When the borrower makes a repayment to the lending company, to the bank account, that automatically, of course, is registered in their software. The moment they register in their software, we actually get the information on our end as well. And in that way, we have connected with all the 61 partner, I guess, we have today. And we get the information like updated all the time in real time basis.
Because I think this IT behind, that's also very important.
Yeah, well, that's why we have
one of the biggest parts, I think, because you make the communication and everything, but at least this has to work. Yeah,
there's a lot of things. I mean, and, especially I'm given that investors are investing from as low as 10 euros, so they have small loans.
Yeah, yeah,
so the whole process,
around, yeah.
It's like millions and millions of, in total, I think we counted just recently, investors have funded about 4 million loans. And then each loan can be like multiples of fractions because they invest like small amounts. So of course, a lot of things what we do is just to keep on track what's happening. And there's been a lot of work which we have put behind the scenes, which actually investors most likely kind of don't see, which is good, which means that it works.
That it works, but it's very, very interesting for me. I try to get it all. The software, do you offer them help, the loan originators? They need some kind of software that operates with your software, I think.
We give them an API, like kind of a bridge to our software, and then they connect through that kind of connection to us, and then we can help them kind of in this connection phase. But in general, it's fairly kind of standardized API, so they can do it themselves, and with a good kind of focus, they can do it actually in a few weeks.
So it connects with their own software?
Yeah, well, it's their own software, basically, through the connection, like a bridge between our software and theirs, they connect to us,
Okay. Yeah, it was just an additional question because now we came to this, maybe, I think in this situation, it's also interesting to connect again to the investors.
Mm-hmm.
Also an additional question right now because of this topic.
Yep.
So for example, if Mintos goes bankrupt, we don't think so, we don't hope so, mm-hmm. and I believe it will not, but for case, there is a direct connection to the loan originator and to the, at least to the borrower.
Actually, in most of the cases, it's going to be to the borrower. So as an investor, I have a claim toward the borrower. So legally, the borrower owes money to me as an investor, right? Well, you as an investor or anybody as an investor, right? So basically, if Mintos would go under, or even if the lending company would go under, you still legally have a claim toward the borrower. So borrowers still have to give back the loan they took, right? And that's why the loan performance is so important. So the borrowers, if they can service the loans and the loans are performing, then there are no problems for investors. If we would go out of business or the lending company, then the question is how do you collect this money, which
exactly
borrowers
I'm thinking
have to...
about it because the software and everything is...
Yeah,
like
how they do that. So basically, there we are looking into contingency plans. So for bigger lending companies, we might have... third parties who come in and actually take over the collection mm-hmm. service, and then the only question is how you collect the payments. Once they collect it, then passing them to investors is relatively kind of doable because we have all the information in place. So that's what would happen in case Mintos would actually, if Mintos would go out of business, it's a less of hassle because the lending company is still able to collect. And then past investors. If the lending company would go out of business, then we would cooperate with the third party who would substitute the lending company and then make collections on behalf of investors. And then we would transfer it to investors.
So just to summarize it, as long as Mintos is working, it's not such a problem for the investor because you do all the work for the investors because you will take care about.
Of course.
If Mintos itself is going under, then it's a bit more difficult, but maybe somebody else has to take this software and
Exactly. I mean, yeah. Then it's like a typical bankruptcy procedure where an administrator would come in, they would do their job and do it in an orderly manner so that all the parties involved would be kind of satisfied. Yeah. Of course, it never is an easy process, right? So if it in an unlikely scenario would happen, of course it would not be easy, but that would not mean that investors would kind of lose their claim toward the borrower. They will still have a claim toward the borrower.
One case that the loan originator goes bankrupt, I think we already had, it was Eurocent?
Yep.
Eurocent, yeah.
Eurocent,
okay. Don't know the spelling. I'm happy I had no claims from this loan originator, so I lost no money. Mm-hmm. But I think it was also a good learning for all of us, also for the investors, because we just saw how it's working and it can happen, of course.
Of
it's
course.
Also good always to have in mind that it might happen, of course. Yeah, and that's part of the game, of course. Yeah, that somebody goes bankrupt in business. Yeah,
and in that case as well, still we are still in the process. It's still the.
Yeah.
We are waiting for the court decision, and basically in total there's around 200,000 euros. There was a total portfolio, and investors still hold the kind of claim toward the borrower. What we are waiting for is a decision how that money, which is like being collected now to euros, and how can we actually can get hold of it and then transfer it to investors. So that's also still in process, and obviously it takes. As we see, it takes quite a bit of time, but it's still there's a reasonable kind of chance of recovering.
It takes time, but you take care about it. Investors
of course.
Just have to wait at least, get information as soon as you have information, and will not lose all the money. There might be no buyback now because it's bankrupt, of course, but there is still this claim, as you explained to the borrower. And the question is only like the operation, how do I get the collected money back to Mintos and its investors? Yeah, so there will be, of course, some loss, but not the whole 200,000 euro. Yeah, so. And we also have to say that's only one small loan originator of all we have.
Yeah, so I mean,
it's very small
portfolio, it's like 200,000 euros. If you look in the kind of grand scheme of things, so today investors are investing like 200 million more a month, right? So it's a relatively small, but still, loss is loss, and we are doing our best to actually work with involved parties and waiting for court decision at the moment.
I feel sure about this. So now I think we should go back to the prepared questions because this was all spontaneous right now because of this interesting talk we had here. Okay, then maybe an additional question. It was just interesting for me, but maybe I read it wrong. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
You paid nearly no taxes this year, I saw it on the financial report. I like it
it's
not to pay taxes, but how did you do this?
Because we had losses before, so you can carry forward your losses and then you don't have to pay corporate tax.
Okay, I see. Then I think I want to go back. We already said, okay, we have neither the same place right now like last year, a little bit of different office. But... last year you told me, I don't know which direction, a new office, very nice office on the rooftop, I think.
Top floor, yeah.
On the top floor, and what can you tell me about this? When will it be finished? When can we make a tour through this office with the camera?
You might actually with the camera look already maybe today, but it's still in construction, so basically...
Yeah.
We are expecting to move in end of August or start of September, and that's going to be in total we're going to be able to seat about like 250 people, so like a good capacity
like
for
a final goal or not final but next step next level
I mean already today, so if you see look at the hiring plans, so by the year end we're going to be closer to 150-200 people, so in the office it's getting too kind of packed already.
So we'll be the right size for a new office. Maybe we can make a tour.
Let me see. And,
it would be very interesting, I think, for all of us, just to have a look. You know, we're always interested in such stuff, and a lot of investors. I mean, I'm here regularly, and I will come back. I feel sure about this because I really like the place and the city.
Yeah, sure.
But a lot of investors, of course, are sitting in Germany, are sitting in Switzerland, Austria, or wherever in the world, and they cannot come here. Yeah, so I think it's interesting to get some information for them as well, and maybe make a short video about this. Then I come to another very, very hot topic right now after 20 minutes of interview, but I'm very interested in this hot topic. At the moment you have plans, and I think it's also because of legislation in Latvia, For this electronic money banking license. I hope it's the right wording right now. You told me in Stuttgart. And every investor might become his own banking account with an own IBAN, which probably gives a lot of new opportunities for more services, I think. Can you explain us these plans and give us some more information what is coming up? Because I'm very interested in this as well.
Yeah, sure. So basically what we are applying for is an electronic money institution license. It's actually European-wide license. And in general, when we look at the about licensing and regulation, the fact that we sit in Latvia is great. Yes, we operate from here, but all the kind of regulation licensing, we have to look at the countries where we actually operate, right? So what happens is Latvia is only covering like Latvian kind of investors and lending companies in most of the cases. When we look at the electronic money institution license, that allows us to give bank account numbers, like your IBAN number, to the investors. And what we see is basically that's a natural step to providing more services to investors, and that would be just plain more value to investors, so that's much simpler for them to use Mintos. They would not, because today to transfer money to Mintos you have to use your bank account on your name, transfer to Mintos, and only to get your money out you have to transfer back to your bank account. There's some friction with IBAN, so basically you can transfer money to your IBAN account from whatever account you wanna. You can even transfer salary to your account or any other kind of funds. And then you also use this, of course, if you wanna, you can use it for investments. And then if you wanna access that money, you can do it as in any other kind of bank account. You just either access it directly, use it to, I don't know, pay for your rent, for your mortgage, whatever, like the same way you use any bank other bank account. So it's less friction accessing money. Yeah. And then on top of that, it will be also a Mintos card. So we will give you another way how you can access money, which is sitting on the Mintos account. Again, if you want to pay for your groceries, why do you have to, today you have to transfer out from Mintos to your bank account, use your card, but then when you have Mintos card, you can do it like straight away from Mintos.
It's like a bank card, or you can pay at the cashier.
Your usual MasterCard.
The MasterCard, okay, that's very interesting. And when is it? I'm waiting for it.
It's hopefully it's going to be this year, but let's see how it goes. Most likely it's going to be early next year.
Okay. I'm waiting for that. I'm really looking forward to that. So I think we can come to the final question because it's already nearly 30 minutes. How do you see the future of the company?
I think what we do is basically with the help of technology, we can make financial services better as such, like in general financial services. And that's what we're doing. So going from offering just kind of one product, which is, in our opinion, very good kind of new and great kind of way of investing, and offering other products, be it like Mintos IBAN account, be it Mintos card, also be it other investment opportunities, and then providing all it on mobile kind of, this is also what we're doing actually, like in fall we're gonna launch our mobile app as well, so finally you're gonna have a mobile app as well from Mintos, and basically with the help of technology make financial service better for our clients, and those clients are those people who want to save and they want to invest, and make them life better in terms of serving their financial needs.
Yeah, I think exactly the same way, and I really love it. How do you see the future of P2P lending?
I think it's a good question how you define these days, like what's a P2P lending, right? Because true P2P lenders, like who really connect like directly both borrowers, investors, there are a few, but I think what we see is that most of the players are actually like there's only like few big players, right? And they are focusing on specific verticals, which is great. But I would look much more in the P2P. I would even look at like P2P lending itself is just one part of a broader space, which is alternative lending.
Yeah.
And this is also where we operate. So because all the lending companies we work with, many of them have been lending for like years and years. It's not that they just started, right? And this alternative lending space in general, I think, is going to continue growing. So what we're going to see is alternative lending going to take more and more business from the banks, in my opinion. Banks going to remain with mortgage loans, definitely, and with corporate loans to like blue chip companies. Everything else, like consumer loans, point of sale, invoice financing, small business loans. I think that's going to be more and more we're going to see on alternative lending kind of companies doing that. And we see it already today. Like, who knew that the same Amazon would be the biggest small business lender? Like, today they are like huge, lending like billions and billions to small businesses who are using their marketplace, right? And it's not bank anymore involved. So that's what I see, like, in general happening in alternative lending space. And then P2P, of course, going to be kind of subsector of this alternative lending as well.
Yeah, perfect. I'm, to be honest, really the same opinion also on my side. And I think that's a very interesting point, because at least with this intelligent software, you can save so much money and have at least a better service for the clients on the side for the people who take the loans, as well as the investors.
Of course.
And I mean, in those days, you get about 12% return, I think, on Mintos. Maybe 11, 12 per year return. And I think there are not many investments where you get this kind of fixed income with monthly return, because you have not all loans, but most of the loans have monthly payments. And I think that's a really very interesting kind of fixed income in those days with intelligent software. And I think that's a good finish of this very, very interesting interview. I'm very, very thankful that you take this time for the interview and for all our viewers. And I think it helps really a lot if the CEO says, okay, I do this and I give the information and the trust to the investors. So thank you so much for that.
Also
for
coming.
My own side, because it's also very interesting for me as an investor, not only as a YouTuber. And for those who watch this video, if you have any questions, just put it in the comments, please. I always like to exchange, because everybody of us can learn about this. Also myself, I learned so much because I did this interview, something I didn't even think about. And then people wrote me, how is this, how it is. I said, I don't know, but interesting to talk about it and think about it. So everybody can learn. Just put it in the comments, please. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up, please. If you don't like it, maybe tell me what I can make better. And if you're interested for more information, I will put the link in the description to your platform, and then there is everything on the platform. I think there is no page where you can find more information.
To answer any questions.
And maybe we can make a short tour. You will mention
maybe we can
do it, and it would be very interesting. And maybe there will be some kind of opening party.
Yeah, well,
for investors,
most likely.
Just as an idea.
Let's see.
I will come back to Riga. But I will come back anyway. Okay, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Martin.
Thanks for coming.
And thank you for watching.
Okay, bye.